So first off, could you just give us a bit of your own background in oncology?
Yes, so I am a physician and now a scientist. I have a PhD in epidemiology from Columbia. And so I'm a cancer epidemiologist. And I am the associate director of the Cancer Center at Mount Sinai for population science. My area of research is lung cancer.
Now, can you explain some of the racial disparities that you've observed in the diagnosis of early stage lung cancer?
Sure. So my group is in general interested in health disparities and in the whole spectrum from from risk factors, early diagnosis, treatment, and outcome. So we have done a lot of work on lung cancer, because that's my area of research, and we have started with disparities in the control of smoking and passive smoking. As you may know, but public housing in New York passed an anti-smoking law in their hallway just last year. So until last year, it was allowed to smoke inside a public housing in New York. So, and going down the road for screening, there is disparity in lung cancer screening. This disparity was due because there was no insurance coverage. But then very recently, Medicare started coverage of screening. So one of the barriers has been taken away, but still people are not informed, they are reluctant. There are a lot of barriers to do lung cancer screening. So what that caused is a diagnosis for minorities that is at later stages. So later stages of lung cancer means less survival. So stage one right now has almost 60 to 80% survival. If we go to stage two and three, survival drops dramatically. So screening is a cornerstone for early detection. Minorities have less access to screening than white populations. And then we start looking into treatment. And what we observed is that for early stage lung cancer, where the recommended standard of care is surgery, African-Americans, for example, receive way less surgical treatment than white counterparts. So they don't receive the standard of treatment. And when they do, survival is the same. So this is an important message. It means that if minorities have a chance to receive the standard of care as white populations do, they would do as well. But unfortunately, they don't receive the standard of care. And the reasons for that could be multiple. It could be that the physician doesn't recommend the standard of care. It could be that the patient doesn't feel, well, it wants to undergo surgery because maybe of the time they have to take out of work, the cost, co-payments, or the fact that they need then family support for the time they are convalescent from surgery. But the net result is that they don't receive standard of care. They receive more chemotherapy or radiotherapy than surgery. And that affects outcome, unfortunately. So this is a little bit what we've been working on. And we have repeated the study within the VA, for example, because one of the questions was, well, maybe people don't have the same level of coverage. Even if they are insured, they don't have the same level of coverage than whites. But then we look into the VA, where the coverage is universal, is the same, and we observe exactly the same results, and we have published it. So Black people insured with the VA system receive less surgery than their white counterpart.
So what do you think healthcare providers could do to try and mitigate these disparities?
Yeah, so I think that there are several ways. If we think of screening, a lot is about information. I think people don't even know. Physicians, like general practitioners, don't even know that screening could be so beneficial. So they don't recommend it as strongly as they recommended our screening or lifestyle changes. So it's a lot about information, I think, for screening. The other thing the health provider could do is to go out with the screening in the communities. We know for breast cancer that worked, and we all know about those vans that go around and bring screening in the communities. That works really well. In terms of the treatment, I think we need to, and we're doing it now, we need to do focus group in among patients and understand whether it was their choice to refuse surgery or was the communication with the physician some implicit bias by which the communication was not perfect. And then we need to solve that by opening up a conversation and just be forceful in explaining that it could be, you know, a hurdle to go through surgery, but that's what can save your life. And so it's worth the difficulties and the hurdle. Yeah.
So on the flip side, what could patients do to try and sort of advocate for themselves in this space?
Yeah. So the one thing we find very useful is having patient advocate who are aware of the cultural barriers of their own neighbor and their own community. And that's the best way to connect to the other patients and just communicate what were the factors that were worrisome for the patient and what was the transition of thinking that patient did. And that's usually the best way to have somebody who can advocate for you in a community and in the health system.
So I know your research in Harlem led to the initiation of a screening program at Mount Sinai. Could you speak about that research a bit and the program that it then led to?
Yes. So we at Mount Sinai, we have the very, very first screening program that was developed in the US, because Dr. Henschke and Yankelevitz were at Cornell when they developed lung cancer screening, and then they moved to Sinai and they brought their all work at Sinai. However, the use of the screening was very low from all the minorities and the areas that were around Mount Sinai. So one thing that we did is the Cancer Center has a community engagement program, which has the main scope is to engage, as the name says, engage the communities within our research and our development of useful implementation of research. So the first thing we did, we look and evaluate screening rates and mortality for lung cancer in East and in Harlem and East Harlem, which are part of the area. And we discovered that screening rates were very low and lung cancer mortality was incredibly high. Although the incidence of the cases were the same more or less as the rest of the city, but mortality was really high, meaning that the diagnosis was at later stages and the treatment was not optimal. So we then embarked in a series of activities. One was to go out and understand the community needs with a survey, understanding why this was happening and collecting data through the Cancer Center. The other one was to develop a witness program so that somebody would go into the community and the churches, in the faith organizations, the community centers, and explain what was how the screening worked and why it was important to go for screening. And the third branch was to go out and try to recruit people for screening with ad hoc programs. And right now, if you look at our staging, the lung cancer staging at Mount Sinai, half of the cases are stage one. We have one of the highest stage one proportion in the city, And that reflects the fact that we have been very active in bringing in, through all these activities, of bringing in patients and candidates for screening at early and detecting early stage cancers. So I think it's kind of successful in a way. I hope it keeps up, because we see a lot of fluctuations. For example, for breast cancer, we see fluctuation in rates of screening according to the coverage, insurance coverage. So when Obamacare kicked in, screening went up. And then when Obamacare was kind of chipped out with changes over time, screening rates went down. So I hope that we can keep up with the lung cancer screening the same in a way we are now in these communities that have difficulties in coverage, in insurance coverage, obviously.
So for those who don't know, what individuals would you say should be screened annually?
Right, so there are very clear guidelines that have been developed by the Health and Human Service. And so these are people over 65 who are currently smoking 30 or more pack years of cigarettes, or who are ex-smokers less than 15 years of 30 or more pack years. And so the guidelines are clear. I think that the general practitioners need to be informed that every time you see a patient of that type, you need to at least spend one word and say, well, you should really go for screening. What do we do at Sinai? We have a program that is funded by National Cancer Institute. So we go through the electronic medical records and we identify people who are going through Sinai for any other reason, let's say, earache or whatever, an infection or a delivery, for example. And if they meet those criteria, we just send them to a quit line for smoking and we inform them that they should have screening. So we try to close the link in several different ways to try to inform people, but the guidelines are there. Although I have to say there is a whole chapter that still has to be addressed. So for example, minorities smoke less than whites in terms of quantity, but they have high risk of lung cancer even smoking less than white population. And there is a whole literature behind that. Partly is because the metabolic gene polymorphism are different. So the metabolism of nicotine goes through different pathways. Partly is because they tend to smoke menthol cigarettes. So the smoke goes more deeply into the lung. So it's more dangerous. So the net result is that they have lung cancer as much or more than white population. But sometimes they don't meet the criteria for screening because they smoke less. So there should be a whole revision of the screening guidelines according to different race and ethnic backgrounds. And that hasn't been done yet at the central level, at the federal level. But yes, that's still a problem there.
So that's all I have for you. Is there anything that I didn't ask that you think is worth mentioning in this space?
There's one thing that is very innovative that we're thinking through, which is to create a van that goes out with lung cancer screening. And the innovation is that a difference from other screening, this is a scam. So it has a lot of logistical problems, such as being isolated, having the right personnel. So it's more of an enterprise than sending out a van for mammography, but we are working on that. And the other thing that I think is worth, we have an integrated program so that everybody who goes through one screening, let's say breast cancer screening, gets informed of all the other screenings, lung, colorectal, so that we try to maximize. Once a person is reached by one screening program, we think it's worth telling that person about everything else in an attempt to bring them on board with the other screening, so to be as efficient as possible. So those are two important things that we're doing now.
Well, those programs sound fantastic, and hopefully more institutions will start to do the same thing. Thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me. I really do appreciate it.